Roy Hayne.
This next solo is from my book, Modern Jazz Solos for Drum Set. And this includes 10 solos in the style of, has a CD, and you can go on the publisher's website and download the MP3s. The one I'd like to talk about today is Roy's Ruse. Now, Roy Hayne is one of all of our favorite drummers. As of this recording, he just turned 97 this month, and there was an outpouring of love for Roy and for everything that he had given to drumming. Roy Hayne says he doesn't really ascribe to rudiments. Like, he doesn't practice them, he doesn't really know his rudiments. But I found that every once in a while, you have to use a rudiment to express the musical idea that Roy played. So we'll find out more about this as you listen and watch me play Roy's Ruse. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. Okay, so let's talk about Roy. Roy's Ruse from my Modern Jazz Solos for Drum Set book. This is a complex solo because I took this solo from several different places. And so there's a lot of different moods that Roy Hayne sets on playing a solo like this. So we should probably discuss those in depth. Let's start with the first part of the solo. It's sort of a disjunct thing. There's a lot of space, there's a lot of different techniques where Roy plays his bass drum and hi-hat together. He plays a dead stroke on the snare drum like this, so that when he plays a stick shot, it doesn't sound overbearing or... It gets that nice tight sound. That's what we're looking for. Something like that. Not heavy, not too heavy. And if you'll pick your wrist up a little bit in your left hand, you'll find that you can get a cleaner sound as opposed to this. If you play match grip, that's fine. But just pick your elbow up when you play that. And you've got to do that dead stroke to get that particular sound. In the second line toward the end, Roy starts to play eighth notes, and a bebop figure that many drummers play throughout their careers. You have to decide, are you going to play those totally straight? Are you going to play them triplety? Are you going to play them more in a bebop, loose eighth note fashion, like Roy does? You notice it's not stiff. I mean, I'm just letting my hands fall. And that, to me, the more that you play along with Roy Hayne, the more closely you will get to that sound. I think that if you'll listen to me throughout, whenever I have any phrasing, I'm trying to get those same concepts underlying everything that I'm playing, whether it's 16th notes or something more intricate between the bass drum and the snare drum. Now, that just takes transcribing some solos that Roy played and playing along with them and making them your own until you can have that Roy Hayne switch that you could possibly flip whenever you need it. We've talked about Roy Hayne as a staccato player, but if you look at the second four measures of 9 going into 17, he actually sounds legato at those points. And throughout the solo, sometimes when he's playing 16th notes, he turns from a very staccato player to a little bit more legato. And I think he does that just so that he can keep his phrasing in touch with what he's trying to play. I'm going to start in the 12th bar to give myself a running start so that you can hear me play measures 13 through 16. 1, 2, 3. So if you make that too vertical and choppy, instead of keeping it smoother, then it actually disrupts your phrasing instead of enhancing your phrasing. So think about keeping your sticks low and moving around the drums in a very liquid manner when you're playing that kind of phrase. If you look at the solo, and especially the section that we just played, 13 through 16, you'll notice that even though it's nice and even and smooth, it's a 3-beat cross rhythm. And this is something that Roy interjects throughout a solo. If you just took the bass drums, starting right there in measure 13, and I played a hi-hat on the big beats, 1 and 3, it would sound like this. 1. And so Roy tends to do that a lot, and he does it at 25, he does it at 57, he does it many, many times where he interjects it in the middle of a phrase, and I use a paradiddle-diddle to play that. And that's da-uh-uh, so it's da-uh-uh-uh-uh-uh-uh-uh-uh. So try that using your feet, and then singing the 3-beat phrase, and then try incorporating that when you practice it in the solo. If you look at number 25, you'll see that Roy starts with a 3-beat cross rhythm idea again, like so. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. But then he immediately changes into some triplets, and then a quarter note triplet, and then ends it with this really furious 16th note pattern. So I call that Roy's ability to stop on a dime with 9 cents change back. I'll play you this phrase just so you can see what I'm talking about. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. So you have to really practice this lick slowly. Because you can't think about a rhythm, a sight-readable rhythm when you get there. It just has to be in your inner psyche. I'm gonna play 25 slowly this time. 1, 2, 3, 4. Now I added a bass drum beat on the last measure just so you could hear where that fits. Let me play that whole last line, four measures before 33. 2, 3, 4, 1. So there's a lot of intricacy just in those four bars. And you can see that I didn't play my hi-hat on 2 and 4, but I played them as a voice with my bass drum. Hey, one of the great things about playing one of these solos is that you can take 2 or 4 bars out of the solo if you like the vocabulary, and you can make it your own. So you could play a 4-bar phrase, and then you could play 4 bars out of the solo. You could take a 2-bar phrase, play 2 bars out of the solo. We're going to give you some examples of that. Before we do it, I'd like to just warn you, please don't play your 4 or 2 bars of time in an academic manner like so. And then go into something really complex like this Roy Hayne solo. Check out Roy Hayne's own recordings to see what does he actually play when he's playing in those 4 bars of time. So come up with something that also emulates the style of this music that you're trying to learn. Let's play 4 bars, and then I'll play 4 bars from the solo and such. Hey, remember, the most important part is not, is it 4, is it 8, is it 2 bars in between, but that you're incorporating these ideas within music that you're playing. So on some of the phrases, I might have lengthened my time playing just to show you what that would feel like. So you could take liberties with that, but you can't take liberties with vocabulary. You have to learn vocabulary, and this is a great way to do it without having to learn the whole solo. If you've enjoyed these solos that we've been working on in Modern Jazz Solos for Drum Set, I would encourage you to check out my first book. It's called Jazz Solos for Drum Set, Volume 1. This only contains 6 solos, but they're of the absolute masters that we all check out. Big Sid Catlett, Max Roach, Art Blakey, Philly Joe Jones, Elvin Jones, and Tony Williams. I know that you'll enjoy learning and listening to the vocabulary that you develop after working through these solos.